Forever is a loving tribute to Chadwick Boseman, an unfocused mess of a movie otherwise, and director Ryan Coogler's weakest film to date. Wakanda Forever opens with the off-screen death and on-screen funeral of Prince T'Challa, the Black Panther, who had been played by Boseman in the first film. In the movie's opening scene, his sister Shuri, played by Letitia Wright, races against time in her laboratory to find a cure for the unnamed illness that consumes him. She fails. Superheroes can do many things, but they cannot raise the dead. And yes, I know that there are superheroes whose superpowers are literally to raise the dead, but you know that's not what I'm talking about here. And more importantly, the audience watching Wakanda Forever also knows that's not what I'm talking about here. Wakanda Forever works best as a study of grief and the limits of exceptionalism. The idea that there are forces outside of our control, and that to be excellent is rarely enough of itself. At certain points in the movie, various characters wonder,
"Have I not given everything?"
And yet the world still crumbles around them. After all, the brutal reality is that it doesn't really matter. Some things cannot be punched to death. For a lot of fans, particularly a lot of younger fans, Wakanda Forever will be a way of processing grief and anguish. Not just literally for Boseman, but also indirectly for a lot of the things that have happened in the world since the original film came out. It deserves a great deal of credit for this. Unfortunately, the movie stumbles whenever it drifts away from this central idea. Narratively, Wakanda Forever is a strange stew of a movie. It is, for example, odd to see the second act of the movie look to the Dark World as a narrative model, and its third act is a less visually compelling riff on the climax of Aquaman. The pacing is terrible, with the movie's central plot only really starting at around the hour and 40 minute mark, telling a story that is largely disconnected from its driving emotional core. Ironically, despite the obvious and acknowledged absence of Boseman, which is handled respectfully and with dignity, the most glaring absence from Wakanda Forever is the fire that Michael B. Jordan brought to the original film. Killmonger ranks among the very best comic book movie villains, both due to the script's fleshed out motivation and to Jordan's raw charisma. In contrast, Namor feels like a clumsy attempt to recapture that hook, right down to the decision to frame him as another, quote, child without love, unquote, who wants to see the world burn in their righteous anger. Wakanda Forever dilutes this motivation further by expanding it to an entire civilization rather than an individual character. Namor's aquatic community is revealed to know firsthand the violence of colonialization that Wakanda had managed to avoid. And look, I am not the person to unpack this, but it does feel notable that both Black Panther movies are more interested in the violence inflicted by victims of colonialism than in confronting colonialism directly. Wakanda Forever is even more erratic in dealing with this theme than the first film was. The script acknowledges the colonial interests of various global superpowers, but never meaningfully unpacks them. There's a completely superfluous subplot involving the returning character Everett Ross, played by Tolkien white guy Martin Freeman, that keeps threatening to become interesting, but never actually does. It's a narrative cul-de-sac. Instead, the villain of Wakanda Forever is a nation that has experienced colonialism firsthand and will do anything to avoid experiencing it again. Still, on the plus side, the soundtrack and production design are great, even if the decision to set large portions of the film underwater means dulling the original movie's color palette. In some ways, the heavy use of CGI underwater in Wakanda Forever feels like a commercial for James Cameron's upcoming Avatar sequel, and his decision to shoot underwater scenes actually, you know, underwater. Aside from all that, there's an early action sequence in Massachusetts that is fun, cleverly and thoughtfully riffing on the soul chase sequence from the original film. Danai Gurira, Angela Bassett, and Lupita Nyong'o are the standouts of the cast. For all the millions of dollars spent rendering the spectacle, Angela Bassett's white hair might be the movie's best special effect, displaying a vulnerability rare in these sorts of productions. It's in these smaller, human moments that Wakanda Forever really clicks. There are certainly moments of beauty and warmth to be found in the film, but there's also a lot of noise that threatens to drown them out. Wakanda Forever seems like it was an impossible assignment, and it's to the credit of director Ryan Coogler that he was able to shape the movie's competing demands into something that was even vaguely coherent. Given all the constraints on top of it, it seems almost churlish to ask for Namor. Wakanda Forever is releasing exclusively in cinemas from Friday, 11th November.